You know what I think the worst thing is the internet's doing to people right now? It's leading everybody to believe that everybody else is an idiot. Especially people that disagree with them. Everybody's first reaction to somebody that disagrees with them is like, oh, you're an idiot. It's like, actually, the vast majority of people aren't idiots. They just either are coming from a different background, have a different belief system, have different reasons, have different, like, it's a whole variety of things. Assuming that somebody else is an idiot, especially when they're professional in their field, is like the worst mistake one person can make. And if everybody stopped just immediately claiming everybody else is an idiot, I think the world would be a better place.
Agogo, many congratulations for this qualification, and please tell me at the end what is the taste?
I don't know what to say. I'm just happy that we're through to the next round. Now we're going to go back and rest, and hopefully we see who we play in the semi-finals.
Every match you have improved. What do
And, you know, we tell little lies to ourselves. I'm the key perpetrator of that. I Creative Spark, which is my agency, was a part-time thing for 7 years. It was my little moonlighting gig as I was working at the Mail and Guardian and other places. And it always stayed this kind of tiny site, you know, and I fooled myself into thinking I was giving it proper attention and time. But the reality is I was just too scared to leave my salary and do this thing full time because I didn't understand how it could make money. I was scared at what I didn't understand how I'd get offices, how I'd hire people, you know, who would want to buy my services, how do I do it? You know, like I just didn't understand how to do it. So I sat in it for 7 years pretending I was an entrepreneur and that I had a company and that it was doing well. And then eventually I got so frustrated with myself, I eventually bought a whole lot of entrepreneur books and went to a cabin in Mpumalanga with my wife, didn't read them, and didn't actually do anything about it. But then a year later, I eventually just took the plunge, you know, And then as soon as I found that I had given this thing full focus, I suddenly didn't have a salary that I could earn. And suddenly the pressure was on. And I actually had no choice but to fully focus on this thing and make it work. And I was giving it 18 hours a day. You know, I was very, very motivated, you know, and there were 1,001 problems I had to solve and 1,001 things I didn't understand. But because I had no choice but to do it, I had to solve them. You know, there was just no bloody choice.
Look, it's been an absolutely awesome experience. I mean, it's been great meeting people from other cultures, people from other countries. Many of the fellow geeks that were on this tour, I mean, I read them on ReadWriteWeb and TechCrunch, they're some pretty big brands. So it was nice kind of meeting them in person and, you know, building networks with them. So from that perspective, I mean, it's been an amazing experience. What's also interesting is it's interesting how much you actually have in common. So a lot of these people I hadn't met before, they hadn't met me, a lot of these people hadn't met each other on this entire trip, but you actually find out that you've got a whole lot in common because you kind of share the same values and interests. And there was a comment at Le Web yesterday which actually rang true for me, and that is, you know, the way we form communities is, the reality is these days you actually have more in common with someone that you probably never met before in a different country than your next door neighbor who lives next door to you. So it's been amazing just a meeting with like-minded people with similar interests, similar kind of cultural outlooks. And what unites us is a kind of love of technology, a love of the web, and a love of innovation. So Sky has been an awesome experience.
So it's all good and well to dream of becoming the next Mark Shuttleworth or even Mark Zuckerberg, but according to a new survey by VentureBeat, tech startups aren't as glamorous as they're sometimes made out to be. Employees and founders are often lowly paid, under pressure. Only 17% of startups are actually pulling a profit. VentureBeat partnered with FMB Clifftop Colony and Curio to poll just under 200 tech startups. To discuss those findings, we're joined by the MD of the umbrella company, Creative Spark, Matthew Buckland. He joins us live from our Cape Town studio. Good evening to you, Matthew. Tech startups are very exciting because they bring innovation, new technology that's good for the country, and it's often quite sexy. But you say it's not all roses. Explain what you think the state of tech startups is following this survey.
Well, I think they are very exciting places, certainly if you're an employee or a founder, to be part of something that's growing and to be part of such a creative environment where you're innovating and pioneering in a business sense, a technology sense, is very, very exciting, especially if that startup, you know, makes it big. But they are very, very tough environments. I mean, we've seen the Mark Zuckerberg movie about how Mark Zuckerberg started Facebook, you know, in his dorm room, and it went on to be, you know, a multi-billion dollar empire. But the reality is obviously very few startups actually go on to make it that big. In fact, in the survey that we did, we found around about only 4% of startups actually go on to get venture capital funding. So it is quite a tough environment. When we surveyed startups, the 200 startups that replied to the survey, we found that benefits were virtually non-existent. Your previous guest was talking about pensions and medical aids. Well, we found that exactly zero startups were actually offering pensions, and only 2% of startups were actually offering a medical aid. It's obviously an affordability factor, but you know, I think it really speaks to how tough the startup environment is. I mean, it begs the question: if the startup environment is tough, why are people doing it? And of course, I think people are doing it not necessarily for money, but you know, to be a pioneer and for lifestyle flexibility reasons and for reasons of a creative outlet.
It's interesting you say that often the founders aren't making much money themselves, and they don't mind because they do have that drive, that need to achieve something. The problem, I guess, is that they have to employ people, and those people want to make cash.
Yeah, that's right. I mean, the survey also revealed that virtually 70% of all the founders of the startups that we surveyed had actually previously worked in a corporate. So these are people that are working in a corporate setting. They're building their networks. They've got a taste of corporate life. And I think they want something.
ブリリアントパーク、フルメタルパニックのガトー商事とパパの言うことを聞きなさいの中島優香が送るテーマパークドタバタコメディ始動。潰れかけの遊園地に2週間で10万人を集客せよ。集客できなければ即閉園。このミッションあまりにも無茶すぎる。イケメン残念ナルシストセイヤ、マスケット銃を持ち歩く美少女転校生イスズ、雨降り支配人ラティファ、その他個性的なキャストたち。聖夜は雨降りを救うことができるのか。天城ブリリアントパーク、富士見ファンタジア文庫より2月20日発売。発売記念キャンペーンも開催中。詳しくはウェブで。
俺と西宮友達になれるかな。
友達、いじめてたやつと友達。
西宮には西宮のこと好きになってもらいたいよ。
キュッキュ
ッ。月とても簡単な言葉なのに理解してあげられなかった。ちなみに西宮、俺はさ、君に生きるのを手伝ってほしい。
映画声の形。
西宮翔子。
リズっていう一人ぼっちの女の子のお話。一人ぼっちだったリズのところに知らない少女がやってくるの。二人はすごく仲良くなってそのまま一緒に暮らし始めるんだけど、最後、
待って、そばにいて、ずっとずっと
そばにいて。
じゃあね先輩。のぞみ先輩と相性悪くないですか。
そんなことない。
うまくいってないの、みぞれと。
そんなことないよ。
ずっとずっと一緒だと思ってた。
あなたには羽がある。どこまでも広がる大きな空があるの。
物語はハッピーエンドがいいよ。
リズと青い鳥。
And that's what came out of it.
Commitment. 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 Pooty-tay.
And you're dealing with this how?
I'm a panther, ready to pounce.
Michael, sweetie, we don't have that sort of relationship.
Oh? She smiled at me. She likes me, man. Because she thinks you're shoplifting. Mm-hmm.
What are these? Pants. Who's wearing them?
You are. But who washes the skid marks out of them?
This is a world in which a group of young Samoan men and women make their way. And the quest is, can they find dates for Sione's wedding? And, you know, in that sense, the quest is set up by the minister.
Okay. Ninja Storm
Ranger.
What is it again?
Ninja Storm Ranger form.
It's Ranger form.
Ugh.
Dude, watch and learn. Ninja Storm! Ranger form! Ha!
yeah, baby, yeah! Well, I guess no one's laughing at the comic book geek now, are they?
Ninja Storm! Ninja Form! Ha! Power of air!
Power of water!
Attack! Wind Rangers! Ninja Storm! Power Rangers! Ninja Storm! All right, boys. Step aside. On your left. All in the wrist.
There's also a handy laser blaster. What's wrong? Never seen a girl in blue spandex walk on water?
Yeah, worked! Yeah! Good job, Dustin.
Yeah. Power Rangers? Nobody told me there would be Power Rangers.
Wind!
Power!
Rangers!
You're impressive against our Kelzaks, but you really didn't think that was all we had to do!
Hey, guys, check me out! This is what I call getting some air!
We've got you covered!
On your wing! I'm going in!
No! Put me down!
You got it!
I'm afraid!
It was awesome. I couldn't believe it, because you watched this stuff as you were, you know, growing up as a kid, and then it got pulled off, obviously, because of the violence. But then giving the opportunity to go, wow, it's Power Rangers, you know, it's, man, it's quite up there. So I got an audition, got a callback, then got my final callback, and I managed to get the role as Red Ranger, which was the leader. And it was awesome because I love martial arts and I love action films, which is my next goal. I guess my love and passion for what that's where it grew, basically, when, you know, I'm actually really good. I believe that I'm good enough to be an actor, I guess, you know, and funny enough, it was martial arts, so I was like, this is heaven to me. So I had a ball, which was awesome, and learning more moves off the stunt, off the stunties was wicked as well. As soon as I finished Power Rangers, I got asked to play Vinny. And then I was like, wow, this is Shortland Street, you know? It's the biggest soap in the whole of New Zealand. So I was thinking, yeah, you're not going to turn it down, obviously. And me being about 22 or 23 at that age, I was like, yes, it's good to carry on a good career. So